Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. I am Blake Vitale. I'm the president of Psi Beta, National Honor Society in Psychology for Junior Colleges of the Mesa Community College chapter. I'm excited to be here. If you would like to participate in Psi Beta or join our National Honor Society, you can come check us out Wednesday in room BP8 at noon. That meeting is open to everybody. We have an upcoming service opportunity on October 17th at Sunshine Acres. That is also open to everybody, and it is an excellent way to meet your honors requirement. Technology is a necessity of life these days, and tonight, Dr. Bev Aqua is here to speak to us on the technology or the psychology of technology. Now, without any further ado, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Frank Bev Aqua.
How close do I have to be? I don't hear. Good. 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 All right. Welcome. Thank you for coming. My name is Frank Bev Aqua. I'm a New England boy. Is anybody from Connecticut? Seriously, where? Old Greenwich. Did I see another Connecticut hand? Where? New Hartford. New Hartford. Okay. I'm from Stratford. And I went to the University of Rhode Island. Do we have any Rhode Island people here? Really? Where? East Providence. Okay. All right. Not a fan of the Providence College, but that's okay. So I like coming out here and meeting people from New England because, like I did, you learn, I don't want to shovel snow anymore, right? So welcome to 110 all the time. After I went to the University of Rhode Island, I came out to Arizona State for my PhD in counseling psych. And I've bounced around the country a little bit since, but I ultimately found my way back here. I've done up to 5 years of inpatient mental health. I hear the average burnout rate for inpatient mental health is 2 years, so I feel like I'm winning or losing, I'm not sure which. But I did 5 years of inpatient mental health with severely mentally ill patients. A little less than a year ago, I started a life coaching and wellness practice. So basically, I take the same set of skills and now I work with the complete opposite end of the spectrum. Healthy people, everyday people, all of us in this audience. I basically help them to achieve goals, to stress less, to set boundaries in their life, to achieve work-life balance. Those are the things that I help people with all of the time now. And the topic that I'm talking about tonight is one that I'm very passionate about and one that I think applies to all of us, which is why I'm here talking to all of you about it. I have at the front of the stage here some of my brochures and business cards. I would love it if you guys came up afterwards. If you're interested, grab some, reach out to me if you have questions. Obviously, we'll answer some questions during tonight, but after tonight, if you want to reach out, if you have questions, please feel free to do that. I think it's important to let all of you guys know why the heck are we here, right? And we're here to talk about technology, right? So now I know when we have presentations like this, a lot of times somebody's going to come up here and remind you all to please silence your cell phones, right? Yeah, that's happened before? Getting some blank stares. So I'm going to take it one step further. I would like you all to take out your cell phones right now, because we all know you have them. So take them all out right now. And I'm going to challenge you to go one step further. Now, I would like you to at least silence your cell phones, right? I would love it if you could accept the challenge for the next 2 hours, turn off your cell phone. I hear at least one gasp, like this is not okay. What are you asking me to do right now? If you are willing, I'm not gonna come around and check everybody, but if you are willing to accept that challenge to turn off your cell phone for the next 2 hours. Now, there may be some anxiety that comes with that. There may be some fear that comes with that. There may be some relief that comes with that. I always love flying on airplanes because then I get to turn my phone off, and it's not my fault that I'm not accessible, right? So I'm giving you permission to turn off your phones for the next 2 hours and not be accessible. If somebody yells at you afterwards, it was my fault. Okay, but they can't call me. Thank you. Don't give them my card. So, just as important as I think it is to let you all know why we're here, I think it's also important to let you all know why we're not here. And I'm not here, to be clear, not here to bash technology at all. In fact, I think technology is pretty awesome. I mean, look at me, I'm literally double-fisting technology right now. I have a microphone, I have a clicker, I have a PowerPoint presentation. I'm pretty sure there's a video being taken right now. I used a GPS to help get me here. This whole thing was set up over email. I mean, how many modes of technology did I use to make tonight happen? I think technology is awesome if we're using it properly. I think one of the coolest, and we probably all have cool stories that something that technology has done for us. A couple months ago, I went to a good friend of mine's wedding, and both he and his bride-to-be are from out of state. He was from Minnesota, she's from Chicago. It was a very, very small wedding. Pretty much everybody that attended the ceremony was flying in from out of town. But her dad couldn't fly in from Chicago. He had just had heart surgery, wasn't cleared to travel, wasn't cleared to fly, and is now gonna miss his daughter's wedding. Now, I don't have a daughter, but I can only imagine what that might be like. I got to see my sister get walked down the aisle by my dad, and I see how important that is, and he was about to miss his daughter's wedding. The cool thing was that her brother was in the audience, and he was able to FaceTime their dad, and he could watch the entire ceremony. Technology can do some pretty cool things for us, but we need to be careful about how much we let it do for us. And that's sort of what I'm here to talk about tonight, is sort of the difference between those things. And just to further prove to you that I'm not totally against technology, I would love it if you went to Facebook and liked my business page. That would be terrific. / Hope Coaching Services, that's me. I share some cool stuff on there, inspirational stuff, motivational stuff, informational stuff, and I basically let my audience know where I'm gonna be, what I'm doing, talks like this. So, obviously your phones are off now, but afterwards, go to Facebook, like my page. Now, why else are we not here? I'm not here to convince everybody that they have a problem, okay? We're not all addicted to technology. Sometimes it might feel that way, right? I'm not here to convince you all that you all have a problem. Keep in mind, I left the world of the severely mentally ill and the diagnosis and all that, and I'm now literally working with healthy, normal, everyday people who just want to be able to do things better. And that's sort of why I'm here today, is to talk to healthy, normal, everyday people who just want to do things a little bit better. Okay? And to further drive that point home, after you're done, go to Facebook and like my business page, / Hope Coaching Services. That's me. Okay. But why are we here today? What are we going to talk about? Well, what we're not going to talk about is all the stuff that we know is already bad, right? Cyberbullying, government tracking, whether you believe in it or not, online stalking, catfishing, there's a show about it, identity theft. So these are all stuff that happens with technology that we already know are bad. I don't need to convince you of that. What we are going to talk about, we're going to dispel some myths, things that we think we can do and we're not actually that good at. We're going to explain the theory of how we became to be so reliant on technology, how it happened, because it sort of snuck up on us. We're going to discuss the effects of technology that it has on us both personally and interpersonally, and hopefully by the time you walk out of here today, you're going to have a better idea of how to do things a little bit better. I'm going to offer some solutions for how to interact with technology a little bit better. Okay. Unfortunately, to demonstrate the first myth in action, I need to break every PowerPoint presentation rule ever by staring directly at this screen and reading from it word for word. Thank you very much. Now, why did you raise your hand?
Because
you want a dollar.
I really want a dollar.
Can we pass that back?
Is it going to make it here?
It better make it there. I do have more money. I do have more money in my pocket. There will be more money to be won this evening. So, hey, I'm not above bribes, people, okay? Okay, so I'll continue to read the bottom of the slide, which I'm imagining a lot of you did. To make my point, I will give $1 to the first person who raises his or her hand, having continued to read to the bottom of this slide. Now, I was actually surprised it took that long, and maybe some of you got there and you weren't sure if I was serious or not and you didn't raise your hand. Every other time I've done that before I turn around, there's just like a sea of hands raised, right? And I don't have that many dollars. So I just pick the first one that I see. But I'm trying to demonstrate multitasking here, right? We're going to talk a little bit more about that. But my first point is, if there's a screen up there and there's a person here, where does your attention go? The screen. I'm literally losing out to a screen. Believe it or not, we all lose out to screens all the time. That's part of the reason why I asked you to turn your phone off. Because even though it's silenced, if it's still on, that temptation to just sneak it out of your pocket and to look and to see who's wanting to hang out later, to see what's going on, to see who updated what, that temptation is still there, right? And I know, as good as I am at being up here, I cannot compete with your phone. I can't do it. I can't even compete with this screen. If I put too many words up here, I've lost you, and you're looking up here. Given the choice between a screen and a person, we're so conditioned to choose the screen. Okay. Whenever you're ready to look up from your phone, I'm here for you. I love these kind of cartoons. I put them in there a lot. We do that a lot, right? We think we have somebody's attention, or we think we're giving somebody our attention, but we're really staring at our phone. So, multitasking. Can anyone actually do it? Does anyone think that they're really good at multitasking? No one? Okay, there we go. Couple hands. So I need, because otherwise this is really going to put a dent in my next plan. I need somebody who thinks they're really good at multitasking to come up here and prove it. Come on up. She's going to come up, but feel free. I do need two people, so you can come on up too. You get to sit in the chair.
Am I going to pick that chair or something?
No, we're not doing trust falls. No one does trust falls.
Like, that's shiny.
Okay. So here's what we are going to do. We are going to attempt to demonstrate multitasking. You don't have a phone in front of you, but I printed out something that you're going to read. So we're going to have you read something while simultaneously listening to somebody else. Okay? Ooh. Okay. All right. Do not turn it over yet. I'm going to give you that first. Just hold that. Okay. So on the other side of that is a very short story. You can see through the paper. It's only a couple of lines there, right? You're only going to get about 20 seconds or so to read that short story. After you're done reading that short story, you're going to hand me that piece of paper, and you're going to tell me as much of that story back as you can remember. And I have my little scoring sheet here, and I'm going to mark off all the things that you recall. And then we're going to see how you did. Okay? At the same time, to make it a little bit harder, I'm going to give you this one right here. And eventually, I'm going to give you the microphone, because I want you, it's okay. I want you to come stand over here, and I want you to look right at her, and I want you to read that story to her, okay? So you're going to have her in your ear throughout the auditorium reading a story to you at the same time that you're going to be reading that story. And after you're done, you're going to have to recall that story to me. That sound good? Okay. Her story is a little bit shorter than yours, but generally people read faster in their heads than we do out loud, right? So just go ahead, read at a nice normal pace, no rush. You have about 20 seconds from the time I say go, and then we're gonna see how you did, okay? Ready? And turn it over, and go.
A farmer was driving his truck down a dusty road when a dog ran out in front of him. Slowing down, the man watched at the dog. A Belgian shepherd disappeared into a cornfield. The farmer could see the crops needed watering. He searched the skies for rain clouds, but none could be seen.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. You guys can hang out here for a second.
Okay.
You want to start?
No. Thank you.
All right. The story that you read. Tell me it back.
There was a king. He was unhappy. 70 men came to try to make him happy, and he couldn't be happy.
Anything else?
I think that's it.
Okay.
To be honest, I was paying way more attention to the dog.
Okay. All right. Well, good. Because I didn't see that part. But you're now going to be quizzed on the story that she read to you. Hold on, let me get that scoring sheet out. All right. And go ahead and tell me that story back as much as you can remember.
Okay, so there was a dog. It was a Belgian Malinois, but you wrote Belgian Shepherd. It jumped in front into the street, and then there was something about a rain cloud. But there wasn't enough about the dog to remember.
Okay. All right. So how do you think you did on those two stories?
Not even all right, just height.
Not even all right, right. Okay, so now, I mean, we're all of at least average intelligence to above average intelligence, and I imagine that you actually have a really good memory. I have that hunch about you, right? For both, and I was actually expecting one to be better than the other, but for both of them, you were in the severely impaired range. Not your fault. You were set up to fail. If you did really well, this whole talk would be for nothing. So
I failed you.
So thank you. Okay.
It was that dollar you gave.
That's right, you got the dollar too. Okay. So why did we do this? How many times are we staring at a phone and somebody's talking to us and they're like, pay attention to me, and you're like, I am. Well, you are in a severely impaired way. Now, and given the choice, again, between a screen and a person, which one are we going to pay attention to? The screen. And why? Not just because we've been conditioned to do that, but whatever is on that screen is your choice, right? You have chosen whatever you're looking at, whether it's a text message, whether it's a website, whether it's a video, you've chosen that. And who can possibly come along and beat something that you have chosen for yourself on your phone? Now, to top it all off, yeah, and I know you were reading from the paper, but if you had looked up at all, you would have seen her eyes directly down, not paying attention to you at all. What is that like to talk to somebody who's clearly not listening to you?
That's my life. I'm a server, so, hey, what's up? How are you? I have an iced tea. That's every day, so I'm used to that, actually.
And they look up from their phone just long enough to tell you. They don't look up from their phone, do they? No, they don't. I actually have a couple of restaurant stories I'm going
to
tell later, so let's not get too far into that now. Okay, sweet. No, not at all. You actually set it up really well. Thank you. Okay. You guys can have a seat. Can we have a round of applause for them? Thank you so much. So, the idea of multitasking, I mean, it's sort of not really a thing. What are we actually doing? We're serial tasking. What does that mean? It means we're switching back and forth between two things. Now, if we had actually looked at that a little bit closer, my hunch is she read a line, maybe listened to a little bit, went back and tried to read a line, went back and tried to listen a little bit, right? And we do the same thing if we have a phone in our hand and somebody is talking to us. We try to pay attention to what's going on, and we hear a word, and then we go back to what we're doing, and we hear a word, and we come back to what we're doing. That's why a lot of times, has this ever happened? What did I just say to you, right? And how often are they right? Like, more often than you would expect, right? Sometimes that's just dumb luck, okay? And the fact that it was what you just said, the last couple of words that were lingering there, much easier to recall. Do not let that fool you. They're not paying attention to you, okay? Because the memory that they have is severely impaired, okay? They're missing the overall message. If you guys actually heard the stories, I mean, we got a couple of details from the story, but we missed the main themes for sure. And again, that's not your fault. I set you up to fail. If we had done one at a time, I guarantee you would have done great on each one, right? But we try to do two things at once, and generally that means switching between our phone and a person, okay? So when can we actually multitask? Well, we can multitask if we're using different senses, right? So we can't necessarily have two conversations at once. We can't read something and listen at once because those are both competing for our language abilities. But can we vacuum and talk to somebody? Yeah. Can we jump rope and have a conversation? Yeah. Some of us can even chew gum and walk. Like, that's pretty cool. But When we try to do two things that compete for the same resources, we fail miserably, right? So, texting and driving, anyone? Yeah, we're gonna talk a little bit about that. Myth number two, speaking of texting and driving, nothing bad will ever happen to me. Who thinks that? Nothing bad will ever happen to me. I think that, come on. How many of you have life insurance? Wow, way more than I thought. But there are plenty of you who did not raise their hand. Why don't we have life insurance? Because the only reason that we have life insurance is because something bad might happen to us in the future, right? Otherwise, we don't seek that out. We don't need it. That doesn't do me any good right now. The other sort of half to that is I'm doing just fine. There's not a problem with anything that I'm doing. Nothing needs to change. Nothing needs to be different. So let's talk about some choices that we make regarding future consequences. I want you to raise your hand, play along with me. Raise your hand if you brush your teeth at least one time per week. Right, there's always that awkward hesitation, like, did he just say that? Yes, one time per week. Okay, keep your hands raised if you brush your teeth at least one time per day. Okay, I didn't see any hands go down, that's good. Keep your hand raised two times per day, like morning and night. Okay, still most of you, three times a day? Oh, they all went down, okay. There's always one, I swear, every audience I've done this with, there's always one, at least one that brushes three times a day. Good for you. Okay. How many of you are flossing your teeth three times per day? It's always the same one. It's always the same one. That girl has amazing oral hygiene. Good for you. Who's flossing two times per day? Couple of hands. Who's flossing? Who can commit to flossing every single day? All right. More than I thought. Who's flossing at least once a week? Okay, who's flossing the day before you go to the dentist? Or the morning of? And then I always want to know, how do they know that I just did that, right? Awful. Okay. Now, every audience that I've done this with, and I haven't done this with a group of dentists, but I swear it would come out the same exact way. Every group that I've done this with answers the same exact way. In general, the group as a whole brushes more than they floss. One, why is that? And two, why the heck do we care about that right now, and why are we talking about that? My point is, why do we brush? Why do you brush your teeth? Somebody up close that I can hear. Thank you very much. That is like the answer. Why do we brush our teeth? So our breath doesn't stink. Like, it's that simple. That's it. That's why we brush our teeth. That's why we're reminded to brush our teeth frequently, right? If we have bad breath and we brush our teeth, something good happens, right? If we have a date tonight and we want our breath to be fresh, we brush our teeth. Something good happens. That's it. It's that simple. Why do we floss our teeth, or why are we supposed to floss our teeth? I heard gingivitis. That's a good one. So what happens if we get gingivitis? Like, what happens if we don't take care of our gums and our teeth? What happens to them?
They die.
I've never had quite such a strong response before. Yes, they die. And what does it mean when teeth die? They fall out, right? So I've actually, I've given eight or nine talks over the last month to different high school football teams, and I have the same conversation with them as part of a different topic. And I tell them every time, you're much more likely to lose a tooth going out to football practice right now or playing in a football game than you are because you're not flossing, right? My point in that small demonstration is that we're really, really good at doing something that gives us an immediate benefit in that moment, and we're really, really bad at avoiding things that can potentially have a future negative consequence for us. So, how many people think fear is an effective tactic to change people's behavior? Okay. Fear does work, and we're going to talk about that in a second. Fear works in the short term. If there's an immediate threat to something that's going to happen right now, we're really good at modifying our behavior, okay? For those football players, it was when their coach threatens to make them run if they don't shut up, right? They're really good at shutting up for a very short period of time. Fear over the long term doesn't work. We forget about it. We don't think about it. Our brains are sort of wired that way because it would be too overwhelming if we had those negative thoughts all the time, if we had that fear response all of the time. So we're sort of wired to forget about that over time. So I want to show you a couple of clips here. The first one is an anti-drunk driving commercial, and I think I have it up here. Let's hope this works. What if there's no sound? Where's my sound guy?
There's no way to hide it. If you drive drunk, we will find you. Cops everywhere are stepping up enforcement and cracking down like never before.
Sir, have you been drinking tonight? Sir, have you been drinking this evening? Sir, have you been drinking tonight?
Make no mistake, you will get caught and you will be arrested. Over the limit, under arrest.
Okay, what were the very last words in that commercial? I mean, I think I heard it. I like the audience participation. This is great. You will be caught and you will be arrested. That commercial is guaranteeing if you do this, you will be caught. How many of you believe that? None of you. Well, good, because again, if you did believe that, this whole thing would be for nothing. Right, so why don't we believe it? Because people do it all the time. Now, none of us in here, right? But we all know somebody that has gone to a bar, has drank, even if it's only a couple, that still is gonna put you over the legal limit, and they drove home and nothing bad happened. They didn't get in an accident. They didn't get arrested, they didn't get a DUI. You can even hear stories, oh man, there's no way I should have been driving, but I made it home, I'm fine, right? I mean, good for you, lucky you, right? But we have examples all the time of that not happening. If you do this, this will happen. It's not true. We try to do the same thing for texting and driving. We try to scare people into saying, if you text and drive, one, you're gonna decapitate yourself or someone else, or two, you're gonna get a ticket, or you're gonna get arrested, or something negative is going to happen. Now, all of those things are absolutely possibilities, but does that fear work to control our behavior? Not necessarily. So I wanna show you a texting and driving public service announcement.
Il y a une publicité qui vient de tomber, je ne sais pas si tu es au courant, il y a toutes des mesures au niveau sécurité routière qui vont être prises. On va au contraire obliger les gens à savoir utiliser la GSM en conduisant. Dans le périmètre maintenant, on va devoir passer à la TGSM. Tu dois pouvoir envoyer un SMS et éviter un obstacle et passer à côté.
Oh putain, ouais.
C'est pas moi qui l'ai inventé, tu peux bien le laisser, voilà.
Ouais. Il y en a beaucoup qui vont se cracher avec
ça. Ah, je vais hein. Voilà, ton GSM, je vais chercher les prix.
Regarde, puisqu'on s'en va.
Ah oui.
Oh là là. Nous rentrerons en retard ce soir.
Et attention que je corrige les fautes après.
Regarde comment tu m'écris le code. Cool.
Oh, c'est impossible. Ah,
je suis de retour ce soir.
Là, ça te venait, hein.
Bon, t'imagines ça, c'est un enfant.
On va, vas-y. 400.
Ah,
honnêtement, j'ai l'impression d'être un connard qui ne sait pas du tout conduire.
Voilà, exactement.
J'ai écrit n'importe quoi.
Tu n'auras pas contacté pour
ça. À cause de ça, ben c'est dangereux ce qu'il vous fait.
Si la loi passe, je roule plus.
Non. Tu tournes, oui, mais...
Regarde ta route.
Non, mais j'arrive pas.
Il va y avoir des tuyaux.
tuer.
Il va y avoir des tués, hein.
Il va y avoir des morts sur les routes.
Je sais pas conduire, attraper mon GSM. Moi, je sais pas faire les deux, quoi.
Ah. C'est trop dangereux.
Does fear work? Sometimes, in the short term. Now you guys, yeah, I mean, you thought that video was pretty funny. I thought it was kind of funny too, right? And that's sort of the goal, right? If I can make it funny, I can make it memorable. And if I make it memorable, hopefully you'll get the message that I was trying to convey, right? In that video, the message was, don't text and drive. Now, keep in mind, where were they? Did you catch that? Not geographically, but they were at a driving school. These were people that were learning to drive for the first time. Now, how good are we? I remember when I started learning to drive, I couldn't listen to the radio, right? It was hard, and still, I promise you, you all do this. If you're trying to find some new location as you're creeping down the road, did you ever lower the radio? Did you ever do that? Yeah. Of course we do. Because the more effort that we have to put into one activity, the more we need to lower sort of our sensory input from other activities, right? These were people that were learning to drive for the first time. Do we expect them to be able to text and drive effectively? No. No, we don't. We don't expect them to change the radio effectively while they're learning to drive. How many of you, be honest, watched that video and said, I can text and drive better than those people can? Right. Congratulations, that video just encouraged texting and driving. Right, I see some people like, oh no, that's not good. I see enough people on the 60 flying by, texting, taking selfies while they're driving. I don't get it, right? Here's a little secret. I'm up here preaching to you about how we probably shouldn't do that and how bad it is. I do it too. I would be lying if I said I didn't do it sometimes too, because it's just so tempting sometimes. And we don't think about the bad thing that's gonna happen or that could happen, right? I'm a good driver. I'm so good, I can text and drive. I can text and drive better than that person. I will literally be texting and driving and looking over at the person next to me texting and driving and get angry at them. Because who are they to text and drive on my road? I'm literally up here telling you about technology and how it can be dangerous if we don't interact with it properly, and I'm just as guilty, and I would be lying if I said that I wasn't. So what can we do instead? If fear doesn't work, is there something that we can do instead? And the message that you're gonna hear me say a couple of times throughout tonight is that we can't be afraid, we can't work away from something, the fearful thing, the bad thing, the negative consequence thing. We need to decide that we want to work toward something, toward being a safe driver, toward being a good friend. And sometimes that means interacting with technology in a different way. If we can do that, work toward something instead of away from something, we're much more likely to be successful. Okay. How did we become so reliant on technology? Now, I use the word reliant, not addicted. We are going to talk a little bit about addiction later, but how did we come to be so reliant on technology? Because it sort of snuck up on us, right? Now, most of you are what, 18 to 22-ish? Most of you anyway, right? I'm 31. The internet, I guess, sort of started becoming popular around the mid-90s. So when I was 10, so my earliest childhood, I guess, was sort of without technology, without the internet, definitely without a smartphone. My first phone was this cute little Nokia phone that had Snake on it. That was super fun. Yeah, I love Snake. I was so good at that game. But it was one of those like yellow screens, and it had like the little black thing, like right. That was the first cell phone game, right? And I was a sophomore in high school. So I'm not, I guess, you know, an older generation person who's trying to be like, oh, look at you kids these days and your phones and what are you doing, right? Like, I get it. I for the most part, I grew up with it, but I had a tiny glimpse of what it was like without it. In a very short period of time, it went from like nobody had it to everybody has it and everybody needs it, right? So how did we come to be so reliant on it? Now, for a lot of you, this may look familiar. It's definitely a psychology 101 type of principle. Rewards and punishments. Whether we actually know these terms or not, we do this every day of our lives, right? So I'm going to run through it really quickly just to make sure that we're all on the same page in terms of understanding what's up here. If we want to increase behavior, what do? We reinforce it, right? And we can reinforce it in a couple of ways. We can give you a reward. I gave somebody money before, and I'm going to do it again. So, or sometimes we can take away something that's unpleasant and reinforce them to do it. So how many people, if you don't wear your seatbelt, if you don't click your seatbelt in right away, it starts dinging really annoyingly? Right. And then as soon as you click it in, it stops dinging? That's negative reinforcement. I'm taking something away that you don't like to make you do something that I want you to do. Okay? Positive punishment, or when we want to decrease behavior, we punish it, right? And we're definitely a punishing society, right? So we're going to give tickets. We're going to put you in jail. We're going to do all of these negative things to decrease the behavior that we don't want you to do. So positive punishment would be something like giving a ticket. I'm adding something that you don't like, or a parent spanking a child. I'm adding something that you don't like in hopes that you decrease the behavior that I don't want you doing. Okay? Negative punishment is like taking away TV time, something that's enjoyable from a child who's not listening, right? I'm taking away something that's enjoyable, hoping that you decrease your behavior. Which of these, in terms of modifying behavior, is the most effective? Positive reinforcement. I think I heard just about everybody say it. Positive reinforcement is by far the most effective at modifying behavior. Now, we're not going to get all into the details of the schedules of reinforcement, but anything that's constant is also going to be really, really effective. Okay? So, to demonstrate one of my favorite clips. We have any Big Bang Theory fans? Yeah.
How thoughtful. Would you like a chocolate?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Oh, sorry, Sheldon, I almost sat in your spot.
Did you? I didn't know this. Have a chocolate.
Thank you.
You're here a lot now.
Oh, am I talking too much? I'm sorry. Zip.
Thank you. Chocolate?
Yes, please. Oh. Hey, Kim. Yeah. You know what? Hold on. Let me take this in the hall. You'll never guess who they got to replace you with.
Okay. I know what you're doing.
Really?
Yes. You're using chocolates as positive reinforcement for what you consider correct behavior.
Very good. Chocolate?
Sheldon, you can't train my girlfriend like a lab rat.
Actually, it turns out I can.
Well, you shouldn't.
There's just no pleasing you, is there, Leonard? You weren't happy with my previous approach to dealing with her, so I decided to employ operant conditioning techniques, building on the works of Thorndike and B.F. Skinner. Yet by this time next week, I believe I can have her jumping out of a pool, balancing a beach ball on her nose.
No, this has to stop now.
I'm not suggesting we really make her jump out of a pool. The bazinga was implied. I'm just tweaking her personality. You're sanding off the rough edges, if you will.
No, you're not sanding Penny.
Are you saying that I am forbidden from applying a harmless, scientifically valid protocol that will make our lives better?
Yes, you're forbidden.
Bad, Leonard. You know, using positive reinforcement techniques, I could train that behavior out of her in a week.
No.
If you let me use negative reinforcement, I can get it done before we go to bed.
You're not squirting her in the face with water.
No, of course not. We're talking very mild electric shocks. No tissue damage whatsoever.
Forget it.
Oh, come on. You can't tell me that you're not intrigued about the possibility of building a better girlfriend.
No, I'm not. Penny's qualities, both good and bad, are what make her who she is.
You mean like that high-pitched, irritating laugh?
Yes.
You wouldn't prefer a throaty chuckle?
You're not changing how Penny laughs.
No, that would be incongruous. Now, I was going to lower the whole voice to a more pleasing register.
Sorry, guys. That girl is freaky!
You come again?
Freaky.
Freaky?
Yeah, freaky.
Have a chocolate.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to make some warm milk and then turn in. I trust if you two are planning on engaging in amorous activities, you'll keep the decibel level to a minimum.
Of course.
Thank you.
These are so good.
Unbelievable.
I was just thinking we should probably turn into...
Well, you know, my new bed got delivered. If you come over and put it together, you can stay at my place.
Really? That's a lot of work, and it's kind of late.
Yeah, but if we stay there, we won't have to be quiet.
Let's go.
Interesting. Sex works even better than chocolate to modify behavior. I wonder if anyone else has stumbled onto that.
So now it's your turn. I'm going to positively reinforce you. Remember, I still have money in my pocket. Okay, I need two people to come on up here. No, you already got my money. Two people that want some money. Thank you very much. Come on up, sir. And come on up. Be honest, who didn't raise your hand because you thought I was going to make you do something silly or weird? Yeah. I'm a little hurt. Okay. Who wants to go first?
Please, sure. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. Your job is going to be super hard. Ready? Right. I would like you to raise your right hand. Congratulations. Good job.
Ooh. Is that it?
No. Round of applause. Come on. She did a good job. I would like you now to raise your left hand. Cool. You can put your hand up. Yeah, sure. Yeah, go ahead. Give her a round of applause.
Okay.
That's called greedy. Okay. But now you have a decision to make. You can earn another dollar. But you have a choice to make. You can either raise your right hand or your left hand. Ready, go. Oh, good. Okay. There you go. Thank you very much. You can hang out here for a second. Round of applause. She did such a good job. I was a little nervous. I thought you were going to raise your left hand. I was...
Like reverse psychology.
No. I'm straight up. I tell it like it is. Okay. Sir, are you ready? Are you ready for your task?
Yes.
Okay. I would like you to start out by raising your right hand. Congratulations. Next, I would like you to walk all the way down there, right across there, and then come all the way back up on stage, please. Okay. So now while he's doing that, so we're not just awkwardly staring at him walk around, although that could be fun for a little bit, Hurry back. Okay. How did you decide which hand to raise when you were given the choice?
You gave me a dollar when I wrote my right hand.
You gave me a dollar. Yes, I did. And you didn't get a dollar when you rose your left hand, right?
Yeah.
So for you, the choice was pretty clear, right? Okay. Hey, welcome back. Congratulations. Here's a dollar.
Oh, thanks. All right.
Okay. So now you have a choice to make also. You can either raise your right hand, or you can take a lap all the way around again. Which one do you want to do?
I'll take a lap.
Really? Oh no.
That didn't work either, so.
Hello. Yes. That didn't work at all. Come on back. I mean, he gets a dollar either way. Congratulations. See, sometimes we have to make the harder decisions in life, and that's what you just said. Thank you. I planned that the entire time. Okay. What was I really expecting him to do? To raise his hand. Why? Because it's easier. So now, what's your name?
Madeline.
Madeline. So Madeline had a choice, right? She did two things. Both were equally difficult. Both took the same amount of time, same energy, same resources. For one, she got rewarded and reinforced. For the other one, she didn't. So her choice was pretty clear, right? Your name?
Brandon.
Brandon. So Brandon had a different choice. He got reinforced either way, no matter what he did. One was very, very simple. One took a little bit more time and effort and energy. Now, just because I'm incredibly curious, how come you chose to decide to take the lap?
Because I thought I'd get more money for doing the harder thing.
Even though I only gave you a dollar the first time?
Yes.
Okay, all right. All right. Okay, so you made an intentional choice to do the harder thing, right? How often do we make the intentional choice to do the harder thing, or to put in more effort or more energy for the same reward? Virtually never. Now, this is a special young man. Are you available?
Yes.
Ladies, this is a special young man. We don't do the harder thing. We don't. And now, when it comes to a screen and a person, which one's the easier thing? The screen. It takes so much less effort to click or to swipe, and we get reinforcement from that. We get whatever we're looking for because we're controlling it, right? What's harder? To actually engage in a conversation with another human being who might piss us off, who might bore us, who might not give us everything that we need in that moment, right? That's harder. It's harder to put in that long term and that extra effort to get potentially the same reward as I can get if I swipe or if I click. Thank you very much, guys. You can have a seat. I will not be slamming my microphone down again. I learned my lesson. Technology addiction. Now, I said I wouldn't talk a whole lot about addiction, and I'm not going to, but I do want to bring it up because I think for some people, this could be a thing. Now, I don't know that there is a specific set of criteria out there for technology addiction. Many of you maybe have heard of or are familiar with the DSM. Anybody heard of the DSM? Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Health Disorders. So that is like the Bible of mental health disorders. And in there is criteria for addiction, namely substance abuse addiction. So, you know, alcohol, cocaine, marijuana, it doesn't really matter. The criteria for all of those drugs are the same. And in some ways, technology is turning into a drug for us, right? It's changing the way that we live, the way we interact with people, and that's what I'm here to talk to you about tonight. So what I did was I took those criteria from the DSM. Now, full caveat, this is not actually the way that somebody would diagnose a technology disorder, but I think if we look at these criteria, you'll see why I did this. So pretty much where it would have said alcohol or marijuana or cocaine or whatever, I just put the word technology in there. Okay, so the criteria are gonna come up one by one on the slide, and I put technology in there. Now, as each of you are reading it, decide which piece of technology you're sort of most reliant on or that you use the most. Maybe it's just your phone in general. Maybe it's Facebook or Twitter. Maybe it's just the act of texting. Maybe it's your laptop. Whatever it is, whatever the thing is that you interact with the most, that you feel the most connected to or would feel the most lost without, whenever you see the word technology, insert that thing for yourself, okay? There's 11 criteria. We're going to run through them fairly quickly. But as I'm going through these, I want you to count on your hands if you think that that criteria applies to you. You can do it low. I'm not going to ask you how many applied to you. But I want you to keep some sort of running tally about how many of these apply to you. And then I'm going to tell you afterwards sort of where you may fall based on that. So let's run through these. Criteria number one. Technology is often taken in larger amounts or over a longer period of time than was intended. So, as an example, have you ever been late to something because you were using technology, because you were texting, because you were watching YouTube videos for too long? If you were ever late to something, or if you looked up and you're like, man, I thought I was only doing this for 20 minutes, it's been an hour and a half, right? If that's ever happened to you, that's number one. Number two, there is a persistent desire or unsuccessful efforts to cut down or control technology use. So have you ever said, you know what, I'm not going to get on Facebook the rest of the night, or I'm going to put my phone away because I need to study, and then you go back to it. You don't stick to whatever parameter you set for yourself, right? So if you turned off your phone at the beginning of this presentation, if you've turned it back on since, number two. Number three, a great deal of time is spent in activities necessary to obtain technology, use technology, or recover from its effect. How much time have we spent trying to get a signal, find a charger, or locate a Wi-Fi hotspot? It happens. There have been so many times where I've seen people desperately running around trying to find somebody that has an iPhone charger. I hope that's, well, I guess I don't hope that some of them were emergencies. I can't imagine that every single time that that person looked so desperate for a phone charger, it was actually an emergency, but it happens. Number four, craving or a strong desire or urge to use technology. So like similar to before, if you cannot wait until that class is over, if you can't wait until that meeting is over, if you can't wait until your friend leaves to pick up your phone and to look at it in some way, number four is you. Number five, recurrent technology use resulting in failure to fulfill major role obligations at work, school, or home. So now, are you literally missing deadlines? Are you literally not getting stuff done on time because you were distracted by some form of technology use? Number six, continued technology use despite having persistent or recurrent social or interpersonal problems caused or exacerbated by the effects of technology. How many times have we been asked to put our phone down from someone? Can you please put that down? Can you please pay attention to me? If you're being asked those things over and over again, and especially if you're not complying, if you're defending your use, number six might be you. Number seven, important social, occupational, or recreational activities are given up or reduced because of technology use. Now are we literally skipping things? Are we not going places? Are we not doing things because it would not allow us to interact with the technology the way that we would want it to? Has your battery on your phone ever been really low and that's the reason why you can't go out? Because what would happen if you went out and your phone died? If you're staying home because your phone battery is low, number seven is you. Number eight, recurrent technology use in situations where it is physically hazardous. Texting and driving. If you've done it, and if you've done it multiple times, number eight is you, number eight is me. Number nine, technology use is continued despite knowledge of having a persistent or recurrent physical or psychological problem that is likely to have been caused or exacerbated by technology use. Who thinks social comparison is a wonderful thing? Nope, but we do it all the time, right? We look at a Twitter feed or we look at a Facebook feed and we see everybody's wonderful, perfect life, right? Because everybody else is happier than us and has more than us and achieves more than us because those are the pictures that we see all of the time. Everybody looks so incredibly happy and it just makes me feel sad about my own life. If I continue to seek those things out, I continue to scroll through all of my friends' pictures and posts to see all the wonderful things that are happening, even though it makes me feel awful and I can't stop myself from doing it anyway. Number nine. Number 10, tolerance is defined by either of the following. Either we need more of it or there's less of an effect when we use the same amount of it. Does anybody remember dial-up internet? Oh, good. Yeah, that worked out well. Right? So what would happen if we had to go back to dial-up internet? It would be awful, and we know it would be awful, right? So we need to watch YouTube longer, we need to play with our phone longer, we need faster internet. If something, God forbid, something takes more than 3 seconds to load, I'm moving on, right? I teach over at Chandler Gilbert, and I had them do a Facebook activity. One of the few times I let them take out their phones in class, and we got on Facebook, and they were supposed to find a particular information based on posts from their friends. And I only gave them a couple minutes to do it, and afterwards I asked why they were or were not able to complete the assignment. And I literally had people tell me that they would scroll through and they would see a long post from a friend of theirs that very well could have contained the exact information that they were looking for, but because there were too many words, she just kept scrolling. Right? We're so conditioned to need things faster and sooner and quicker and in a shorter period of time, right? I just need as much information as possible, right? So I'll look at a picture, that's cool, that only takes me a second. If I have to read a couple of sentences, that's too much. And withdrawal is defined by a physiological reaction to the absence of technology or the use of technology to avoid experiencing such effects. So if anybody felt anxiety, or is feeling anxiety related to, oh my gosh, my phone is off, like what is happening? I don't know what's happening in the world outside because my phone is not on right now. If you're literally having an anxious reaction, number 11 could be you. Now, in terms of diagnosing an addictive disorder, for a mild addictive disorder, you only need to have said yes to two. Had that been alcohol, and you had said yes to two, you would be diagnosed with a mild alcohol use disorder. But it's technology, so unfortunately that's not a real thing. But two, all you need is two for a mild use disorder. Four is moderate, six of the 11 is severe. So barely over the halfway mark is severe, right? Keep that in mind. I'm not gonna ask you how many you answered, but keep it, if you were keeping track, keep that in mind as we move forward. Okay. In order to figure out how to do stuff better, we need to sort of understand where stress comes from. Now, this is a model that pretty much every presentation I use, I use this model to explain where stress comes from. Now, normally I go old school and I have a nice flip chart and I use a magic marker and I sort of draw it out, but given the size of this room, I got some really awesome clip art and put it up there. But I'm going to run through this really quickly. The bucket, it's you. The bucket represents your capacity to handle stress, handle stuff as it's happening, right? As we get older, as we age, as we mature, we're able to handle more stuff. A two-year-old, a three-year-old, a four-year-old, if something spills, if something falls, if something breaks, end of the world, right? There's no capacity to handle lots of stuff. As we get older, we can handle a little bit more. Now, our bucket is also influenced by things like sleep, if we're hungry, right? Because how many people get hangry? Yeah. And what does that do to our frustration tolerance? Gone, right? Practically gone. So, to handle stress, most people are hanging out with this cup over here, hanging out in what I call stress management land. That's when you're already stressed out, you're already overwhelmed, there's already so much going on, and you're like, I need to do something to relax, right? So we go running, we go hiking, we read, we do something that temporarily diminishes our stress level. But as soon as that activity is done, we're pretty much right back where we were before, right? It's a temporary relief. So we're literally scooping a teeny tiny little cup of water out, dumping it on the ground over here, but our bucket is still filling up. Why? Because this faucet represents all of the stuff that's happening to us in life, right? Sometimes that water is just sort of trickling out of that pipe into our bucket, right? For the most part, stuff is really good, nothing's really going wrong, everything's great. I mean, there's still stuff happening, but we're fine. And then sometimes, like finals week, right? It just feels like everything is crashing down, right? There's just so much happening. What we don't realize, most people, how many people will say that they use their phone or some form of technology as a form of stress relief? Okay, not as many as I thought. How many people think going to your phone and using technology actually causes stress? Right. So I know a lot of people who say, oh, I'm just going to play on my phone for a little bit. I'm going to hang out over here and I'm going to reduce some stress. You're actually creating more. Why? Because we have to constantly be on. We're constantly available to someone, right? Someone is reaching out to us, we have to respond to them. We're constantly taking in more information. That constant stream of information coming in and that constant need from somebody, that's what causes that stress. Now, I met somebody about a week ago who said that she had to break up with her boyfriend because he was not happy enough with her text response rate. Now, to be fair to him, she admitted sometimes she would take up to 3 hours to write back. Now, I mean, that's not acceptable, right? She literally couldn't keep up with the demand of how quickly he wanted her to be available and how quickly he wanted her to respond and to be there, right? She's not an ER doctor. She doesn't need to be on 24/7 call for anyone. None of us need to be on 24/7 call for anyone. But we interact with technology in such a way that we're allowing all of that to come into our lives. So when I work with people, either individually or in groups, I talk about setting boundaries here, setting up something that's going to knock out some of the stress that's coming into our lives. And a lot of times that means unplugging from technology a little bit. Effects of technology. Now, I promised you we'd talk a little bit about how it's affecting us individually and how it's affecting us interpersonally. We've already talked about where stress comes from. And when we use technology all of the time, we lower our attention span, we lower our patience, we lower our frustration tolerance, right? Because what is our attention span like right now? I don't mean literally right now, because hopefully we're all still doing good, right? But honestly, and I'll admit, 2 hours for you guys to come here and sit and listen, 2 hours is a long time. We're not used to sitting down for 2 hours and listening to someone or something without pulling out our phone and taking some break from whatever that thing is and deciding that we want something different. Our attention span is lowered, our patience is lowered. And we're missing out on the world around us. I thought this was a pretty funny picture, right? And so instead of saving the poor guy that's drowning, we're just going to take a picture of him. Now, I saw another one that I didn't include here, but it was like, if the Titanic sank today, and it was a cartoon drawing of the Titanic sinking in the background, everybody's heads bobbing in the water, and everybody's holding up their hand with their cell phone, taking a picture or a video of it, right? We literally miss out on the world around us. Now, I said, I can be as guilty as anybody, so I'm going to share a story about my guilt. Literally happened last night. I'm not from Arizona. I'm not a huge fan of Arizona bugs. Not afraid to admit that. So scorpions, not a real big fan of them. And up until now, the only scorpions I've come across have already been dead until last night, right? So we saw one scampering across the bathroom floor. And apparently, the only person who likes scorpions less than me is my girlfriend. Who knew? But all of a sudden, she starts screaming, ah, it's running, right? So she's running that way, throws her shoe off, scorpion's running that way. So it's just like instinct, right? I just kick in, shoe, smack scorpion, killed it. Woo, right. Thank you very much. I mean, I felt like a hero in that moment, people. Honest to God, and I don't post a lot on Facebook. If you're actually my friend on Facebook, not just following my business page, if you're my friend on Facebook, you'll see I don't post a lot of stuff. But I promise you, in that moment, I had the thought, I should go to my laptop right now, I should log into Facebook, and I should tell the world what I just did. Because I want people to know, and I want people to virtually clap for me. Because how cool am I, right? Keep in mind, this was 30 minutes after I had stopped preparing for this presentation tonight about how we're over-reliant on technology, how we can miss out on the world around us because we'd rather post about it or tweet about it than actually live in that moment. Now, I'm very happy to say I did not log into Facebook and post about it, But I couldn't believe that that thought actually ran through my head. In that moment, that's what I wanted to do, because that's what we do, right? Maslow's hierarchy of needs, another Psychology 101 principle that a lot of you may be familiar with. Really quick rundown. Basic idea is that we have to have certain needs met before we can move on. If we don't have food, if we don't have air, if we don't have water, who the heck cares about getting a higher education and a dream job and a dream house, right? We're literally just trying to survive. Now, assuming we get those basic needs met, we can move up to the safety. So we don't necessarily need housing to live, but it would really help. And if we have the basic needs met, we can move up to housing. My concern is what happens after that. So let's assume we have all of the basic needs, the bottom two levels. Next, we have to belong to something or someone. And that comes before self-esteem. This model is saying that before we can feel terrific about ourselves, we have to have the acceptance of other people. When we're talking about technology, how do we get acceptance from other people? Likes. That's it. It's that simple. That is where we get our acceptance from other people from. That is how we connect with others. And it's only then that we're allowed to feel good about ourselves. Now, some other people are pretty funny, and they modify the hierarchy a little bit. So even more than life, we need battery, Wi-Fi, and the World Wide Web. I didn't do that. I found it. I'm gonna share another video with you. Probably one that you've seen before, but it's hilarious.
Charlie, the demand on this network, it is increasing by the second.
It's crazy, huh?
And people are relying on it more than ever. We cover more than 99% of all Americans.
Oh, no, I can't imagine living without it. It's a place where people can come share knowledge and ideas. It's beautiful.
That's deep, Charlie.
My selfie just hit 100 likes. 100!
Yeah, the headrest somehow made the credits. I don't. So I couldn't find the clip that was just the commercial. But how many of you have seen that commercial before? And it's hilarious. But why is it hilarious? Because it's only funny when it's true. If it weren't true, it wouldn't be funny. We put so much stock into how many likes we get, or how many shares we get, or how many comments we get, or how many retweets we get, right? That is how we feel good about ourselves. We all know what that is, right? Our world is starting to revolve around this ridiculous cartoon thumbs up. That is how we feel good about ourselves. So, what kind of effects is technology having on us interpersonally? So, I'm going to read the cartoon first. Do you mind if I strap your phone to my forehead so I can pretend you're looking at me when I talk? Now, we've already sort of covered that, right? Eye contact, where does eye contact go? Out the window, where's my server? Thank you very much. How a percentage of people that look up from their phone or don't look up from their phone when they're ordering? Good for you. Good for you. And how many times have we seen signs when you're in line somewhere that say, if you're on your phone, you won't be served, and things like that? I think it's kind of sad that we even have to post signs like that, right? But the whole idea of eye contact, out the window. What's worse than that, though, I think we're starting to create some really unrealistic expectations. How many people like romantic comedies? And there's a couple of guys. Good for you. Who's seen The Notebook? Oh, that movie messed me up for a week. It was so sad, and yet it literally made me angry, because we watch a romantic comedy, and there's nothing in that movie that could not technically happen in real life, right? The emotions are real, the events are real, but we're getting such a one-dimensional view of what's happening, right? We don't see this couple live happily ever after and argue about raising the children or arguing about who's leaving the dirty dishes or taking the garbage out, which are all very much parts of life, right? We only see the happily ever after. And it starts to create this unrealistic expectation. Technology is starting to do that too. It's starting to create an unrealistic expectation for how entertaining somebody has to be, how funny somebody has to be, how knowledgeable somebody has to be, because who in here is more entertaining or funnier or smarter than Google? How much pressure do you think I feel coming up here talking about this, trying to keep your attention for somewhere between 1 and 2 hours, knowing all of that I can't possibly match up to your phones? It's a lot of pressure. That's why I had you turn them off. Because then I stand a fighting chance. And it's not because I'm not passionate about what I do. It's not because I don't come up here and I don't have fun with what I do, because I love coming up here and doing what I do. And I think I'm pretty good at what I do. And I still can never match your phones. Nobody can come up here and match your phones. We need to decide that we're going to put that aside for somebody, or else no one is ever going to live up to the expectation that our phone is setting for us. It's creating poor connections with other people. There was a study done in the UK. They had strangers talk to each other, and they either had a cell phone on the table while they talked or they didn't. And they asked afterwards how connected they felt. Literally, just the presence of a cell phone made people feel less connected. That was their self-reporting afterwards. It was even more effective or more dramatic when they were talking about something serious. If they were just, you know, talking about superficial things, it didn't matter as much. But if they were having a serious conversation about something, there was an interference in the connection simply by the presence of a cell phone, let alone somebody actually picking it up and playing with it, right? One of the saddest things that I've ever seen, I saw a dad and daughter out to lunch. It was probably a year or two ago. She was probably 11 or 12, maybe. Initially, they were both sitting down to lunch, facing each other, both on their phones, which initially I thought was sad enough, right? Like, here we are, dad and daughter, and all they're doing is playing on their phones. What made it even sadder was, who do you think put their phone away first? The daughter. Yep. She put her phone away first and waited initially patiently for her dad to put his phone away too. And he didn't. And then she literally reached out and tapped him and poked him and said, "Put your phone away." And he didn't. When do you think he put his phone away? When the food came. Now So as to not be rude to my own company, I didn't stare at them the entire time, but believe me, it grabbed my attention, and I was watching that for probably longer than I should have, but literally broke my heart, because that's what we're now used to. All right, how many times do we see mom and dad playing on a cell phone and kids acting up, and they put down their phone just long enough to yell at their kids for acting up? Right? We see it all the time. And why are they acting up? Because they're getting zero attention, they're getting zero structure, they're not getting what they need, right? And what do the parents feel like? Why can't you just let me be happy? Like, why can't you entertain yourself? Why aren't you potty trained yet? Right? I just want to play my game. Literally, a week ago, there was a family of five, mom, dad, three kids, sitting in the booth next to us. One of the kids was turning around, literally dropping stuff, spilling stuff over onto our side of the booth. And I'm like, why are the parents not saying anything? Come to find out, mom was trying. Dad was hooked on some cartoon game on his phone, staring at it the entire time. It had to have been 20 minutes, just staring at his phone. Didn't even look up to do the yelling, just waited for his wife to handle that. This is what, in my server, is this what it looks like? Because every time I go out to eat, more and more, that's what it looks like.
Sometimes, like, mostly like at the beginning, like when everybody's like getting settled, but once everybody starts eating, people are like in the flow of dining together. But it's like when you're waiting for
Right. The problem is we don't know how to be bored anymore. We don't know how to sit in silence anymore. That's not okay, that's uncomfortable, right? I took note, how many of you, well, you don't even have to admit, as you were coming in and filling in and waiting for this to start, everybody is staring at their lap, and they look really happy as they're staring at their lap, waiting for this to start. The idea of waiting 5 minutes for something to start is now too much. It's overwhelming, right? So it's good that for the most part, families know, okay, once the food is here, now we're back into that regular flow of dinner, right? But what about the ones that as soon as the meal is done, now we're pulling our phones right back out? Those are the ones that scare me even more. Okay, so what can we do about it? I've already told you about how we need to work towards something, not away from it, right? We need to decide that we want to be the good friend or the good spouse or the good family member. We need to be attentive. We need to make it a purposeful action to do that. Unfortunately, that's going to mean unplugging. We need to take periods of time where we turn off our phone, whether it be for a meal, whether it be for some short duration for an activity. If we're hanging out with other people and we're spending time with those people and we care about those people, we need to make intentional efforts to give them our best. And I promise you, our best is not with one hand on our phone. And the scary thing is, we're so bad at being bored, at sitting there quietly, at sitting in silence. I'm gonna show you one last video. It is a meditation video. It's only 5 minutes long. Most of you are probably thinking, oh man, I'm so bad at meditation, right? Because to be successful at meditation, you have to think about nothing. And who's really good at thinking about nothing? We don't like it. It doesn't feel good, right? We should be thinking about something, or we should be getting some form of entertainment. If we want to get to the point where we can reconnect with other people and be okay and bring that patience back up and bring that tolerance back up and be okay with just sort of sitting in silence sometimes and not having to click or swipe or post, we need to practice first getting better at that ourselves. So that is the very last thing that I want to show you. And of course, again, Facebook, hey, Hope Coaching Services, check it out, like it, follow. But I want that video to be the last thing that we do together. So I want to open it up. If there are any questions that have not already been answered, I want to take care of those now, so that the last thing that we can do is that video and we can sort of end on that note. So before I play that video, are there any questions? Okay. Another reminder, I have some materials up front, and I figured I wouldn't pass them out to everybody because I know if it's something that you're interested in, come grab it. If you have questions for me, or if you know somebody that you think sort of needs a little help in this area, come talk to me, or grab my information and reach out, send an email, call me. That's what I really like doing. I like helping people make those changes. So that information is here for you. And I'll hang out for a little bit after we're done here. If you have questions, you want to come up and chat. But I want to end on this video. It would probably help you guys to sort of clear off your laps. It's literally just going to have you sit there with your eyes closed and sit straight up. And it's going to sort of talk you through. You don't have to do anything fancy. And it's a YouTube video that you can go seek out and try out on your own. It's only 5 minutes long. I think it's worth giving it a shot. So thank you very much for having me, and I hope you enjoy this.
Welcome to your meditation. I'm Dr. Robert Eric Dinnenberg, and I'll guide you through from start to finish. Mindfulness is present moment attention without judgment. For this meditation, we'll attend to our feet with mindfulness, and then we'll move on to the breath in the abdomen, and then to finish, we'll return to the feet. So let's get started. With mindfulness, start to observe your feet. Answer this question to yourself. What does it feel like to have my feet on the ground in this present moment? Explore this present moment experience of your feet. You might notice what it feels like to have your feet in your shoes, in your socks. You might observe different points of pressure presenting to different parts of your feet. And you might notice temperature. Simply observe whatever you notice. There's no right or wrong, no good or bad. Whatever you notice is okay. And anything that takes you away from this noticing is a distraction. Any thought about the future or the past, any worry or expectation, any internal dialogue or judgment, notice and let go. With forgiveness, with patience, notice and let go. Notice and let go. And shepherd your attention back to your feet. And when you're ready, let go of your feet and shift your attention to your abdomen. Here we find the home base for mindfulness of breathing. Observe what it feels like to breathe in this present moment. Explore and discover your own way of noticing your own breath. You might observe a rising of your abdomen as you breathe in, and a falling as you breathe out. Your own way of noticing your own breath might include registering an expanding feeling as you breathe in, and a deflating feeling as you breathe out. Ride the waves of your breath with your attention. Anything that takes you away from your breath is a distraction. Any thought about the future or the past, any worry or internal dialogue, any expectation or judgment, notice and let go. Notice and let go. With forgiveness, notice and let go. And time again, shepherd your attention back to your breath. Back to answering this very simple question. What does it feel like to breathe in this present moment? When you're ready to transition out of the meditation, return to your feet. This time there can be some movement in your toes, and notice what it feels like to be moving your toes in this present moment. And let this movement transition you out of the meditation, so as your fingers are moving and, if you wish, your body's stretching, you can transition fully out of the meditation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, guys.